India steps into the new year with many strengths and challenges. Crude is down and so is the country's current account deficit. But the intensely challenging general elections ahead look set to worsen the fiscal deficit. How will all this impact growth? An exclusive CNBC TV18 poll of economists indicates that despite the political overhang, GDP growth in 2019 is expected to be stronger than it was in 2018. The rupee will be stable around the 69 to 72 mark, said a bulk of the respondents to our poll. The Reserve Bank will have headroom to cut interest rates, not just once, but maybe twice. But market yields may not dip too much, given the possible fiscal deficit overshoot. That's the poll. Reality may be far more confusing, with the consensus of the last three decades getting challenged. USA, the global policeman, wants to abdicate its role. Global trade pacts are giving way to bilateral agreements, and firing central bank governors is becoming quite a trend. The purpose of this show is to understand the undercurrents of 2019, and hence an interesting panel. Haseeb Drabu, economist, former banker and former finance minister of Jammu and Kashmir. Tarun Ramadurai, professor of economics, financial economics at the Imperial College London, who has researched on issues as varied as Indian financial savings to the effects of machine learning on credit markets. And Suyash Chaudhary, fixed income fund manager from IDFC Mutual Fund, the only man in this group who has to smell the price of money or the cost of capital on a daily, hourly basis. I would call this a very interesting panel. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining me. Well, first up, let me start with the global backdrop. Tarun Ramadurai is here. Tarun, the global backdrop looks extremely challenging. First up, let me start with the tussle between the biggest economy and the second largest economy, US and China. Is this likely to lead to an extremely fractious and probably declining global growth?
So this is a great question. I think that there are huge headwinds for the global economy in the next year. It is certainly the case that when you're looking at the US versus China, the sort of incipient trade war that we're seeing, it seems like that's a very worrying development. We'd like to think that wiser heads will prevail and that people will calm down the rhetoric and that it won't actually be backed up by a lot of real actions. Mm. But we can't really tell, so there's a pall of uncertainty as a result of that. Mm-hmm. And then we've got Brexit as well.
I was coming to that since you were coming from London. Is this a London problem? I mean, a United Kingdom problem, or will it spill over into a general European and global problem?
So this is the big worry, because I think that there's a contagion potential here with Brexit. If we have a hard Brexit, the fall of the pound that is very likely to result after that, and the fact that the European situation is also very closely tied in because of the current integration of the UK economy with the rest, is likely to send some ripples through a much larger set of countries than just the UK.
Okay.
So, yeah.
The EU itself unraveling would be a problem in 2019. I mean, they've managed to paper over the Italian budget problem. But will the EU pose Grexit, you know, Greek exit kind of problems, or will it be less serious?
See, the big problem with Italy is that, I think we've sort of seen only the beginning of what is likely to be a gift that keeps on giving, over the course of the next year. I think the issues are that the fiscal situation in Europe has never really been addressed to the extent that it ought to be. So I think we all have to be quite worried about the underlying problems in some of the economies that were fairly hard hit even in 2009 and 2010.
Okay. The wounds haven't healed. Let me come to Suyash, because Suyash has to take a call on how liquidity is going to pan out both globally and domestically. But first, globally, Suyash, we thought that we should prepare for 3 or 4 or even 5 rate hikes from the Fed up until 2 months ago. And suddenly that's declining. What about liquidity? Do you think the amount of noise the market and President Trump are making can even change the contraction of the balance sheet timetable that the Fed has put out? How will you gauge global liquidity for 2019?
Absolutely, Lata. It's very much on the table. And, you know, if I just take a step back and look at, you know, let's say early 16 to late 17, you know, that was largely a phase of synchronized global recovery where most major markets, excluding India, grew almost in tandem. Most of 18 was about this synchronization breaking down. While US was still responding to a late cycle fiscal stimulus, the rest of the world, probably led by China, was showing adequate signs of slowdown. Over the last couple of months, it looks like, you know, this phase is now gradually giving way to a synchronized slowdown, which means that finally, at least parts of the US economy are beginning to show some deacceleration. So if you look at housing and auto chiefly, business fixed investments more generally, there seems to be some slowdown. Now, ultimately, and you know, from a first principle standpoint, it's the financial conditions that matter to, you know, cost of financing, obviously, and hence through aggregate demand and eventually to inflation. So with Fed having an inflation and employment mandate, balance sheet contraction cannot be an auto run if it will have significant incremental impact on financial conditions. And I think the New York Fed chief has admitted to that possibility even recently. So I would think it depends on, you know, the pace of slowdown. If one is only reverting closer to trend rate of growth, then the auto you know, rundown may continue. But if it's something more significant, then I would think the Fed would react to it. As of now, we do think the US dollar may have topped out versus at least you know, some part of emerging markets. And that's the base case going into the new year.
Okay. I will come back to you with more questions on domestic liquidity, Suyash. Haseeb, welcome to the show. Well, you know, the consensus or maybe the key trends over the last 3 or 4 years was an inflation targeting central bank in India and therefore a strong rupee, at least over the past 4 years, until that bit of a jitter we saw in mid-2018. And finally, fiscal discipline. Will all this remain in 2019?
Well, we have seen many general elections, and there is a peculiar trend that one observes in, which is really the macroeconomics of elections and the run-up to it and the particular year. We've always seen that there is a shift in public expenditure, both in terms of levels as well as composition. Now, it's unlikely this will happen in this budget because there's going to be a vote on account. But I would imagine that there will be some changes in the public expenditure policy, which would, and also not just formal public expenditure, there will be a kind of an injection of liquidity into the system for the purpose of elections, and elections are big money affairs now in the country. So I would expect that there will be a larger dose of that expenditure in the system, which will generate a certain amount of growth. And every election, year after year, if you start from 50s, has seen a break in trend in that particular year. Now, as regards fiscal deficit, specifically in terms of what the government budgeting do, I am honestly not too worried about it at the, at this point of time. What really worries me in terms of 19 is that you are having an election, and this election could, from whatever one reads, go either way. So far, for the last 20 years, the biggest gain has been that there was a consensus on economic policy, broadly the direction, starting from 91. And that was a big comfort for both markets, for corporates, for businesses, for whatever. For the last year and a half, maybe, or 2 years, I have seen that consensus is breaking down.
In what
and,
way? In
that
what
is
way?
A big worry. So the moment
what's breaking down for you?
In terms of in terms of commitment to a certain fiscal reform process, in terms of the shocks that the system has got, and whether it be in terms of GST or in terms of demonetization, the fact remains that the way policy action, corrective action, is coming through is not what was really thought through. I mean, whether it's in terms of, now you can see farm waivers coming up, you can see how the NPA issue is being handled. A lot has changed, and the kind of consensus you were building towards liberalization, towards globalization, one doesn't see the same thing, both even in terms of fiscal reforms or for that policy, monetary policy. The recent RBI episode being another indication of that. So what worries me really is that, are we seeing a breakdown in that consensus even as governments change and political executive changes. If indeed that is so, then 2019 being an election year will be a lot of uncertainty.
We've seen these competitive fiscal giveaways. The state governments have offered farm loan waivers, and now there is every indication that the central government will also come with either a basic farm income or some kind of a price support which goes into Jan Dhan accounts, or maybe even bigger, a general national farm waiver. Would you worry that fiscal deficit could be a bigger problem than Haseeb is saying?
So I think Haseeb makes a lot of sense that there is a worry that the consensus may be falling apart. But leaving that aside, I am continuing to be worried about the fiscal deficit situation, because it is true that election years are giveaway years. There is a bonanza for a whole bunch of people, which then subsequently we have to pay the piper later on. So at the moment, what we're going to see, we're already seeing farm loan waivers at the state level. It is true that we're likely to see some fiscal giveaways at the central level as well. The problem for that is that just given the high percentages of committed expenditures that we already have with pensions, with transfers to states, with various other things, we don't have a lot of fiscal headroom. And the problem with the lack of fiscal headroom is that even were we to have a consensus about the fact that we want to upgrade public infrastructure, or we want to sort of spend some money on public investments that we might think are very sensible, the problem there is that whatever fiscal deficit targets we breach now will make that consensus also far more difficult going forward. So what we need to do is to find a way to find a consensus about sensible public spending. And I'm not sure we're quite there yet.
Okay. The consensus today is that inflation will be low, that disinflation is severe in food and in fuel, and therefore core inflation, non-food, non-fuel, will also decline. Will that be a trend in 2019, or will that get challenged?
See, the problem with oil prices is that they've been incredibly volatile. So I think one of the things that we've seen is that they went up and then they've come down. But then the issue is that they crash very, very fast, and they also move up extremely fast. I think the general story, I think we're sort of seeing that the mean effects are that inflation is likely to be fairly low structurally speaking. But the big worry is that the surprises are on the upside. So the question there is, how does the volatility of inflation or the expected uncertainty in inflation rates impact us today? Now, if you already add that to the picture of political uncertainty that we're facing, it's the second moment, so-called second moment effects that we should be worried about, which is how does volatility affect our investment decisions?
Suyash, actually, I wanted to get your view on the rate of cost of money. If you take it as the 10-year bond yield, our poll indicated that it will not change much, although people said that they would expect a couple of rate cuts. What's your sense? Do you think the cost of money moves down because of inflation, quite clearly moving towards 2 and 3%? Or do you think, cost of money will continue to remain at current levels?
So, Lata, there are two almost anchors to Indian fixed income market. One is that even at a contained headline fiscal deficit number, which let's say it's around 3.3 for center and, let's say around 3 for states, the combined borrowing of state plus center now is in the vicinity of 11 to 12 lakh crores, which is, eventually every year leads to crowding out unless there is a third balance sheet that steps in. Now, this year it's been the RBI who will probably take up around 80 to 85% of the net borrowing program of the Government of India via the OMOs that they are doing. Last year, it was, FPIs, at least till early part of last year, it was FPIs which took out some bit of this. If it's only domestic balance sheets absorbing the supply, there is crowding out, and that needs to be addressed. We need sustainable pools of savings to take out this amount of financing. The other pillar of India is you will be perpetually in liquidity deficit, assuming balance of payment is constant, because every year you will lose between 2.5 to 3 lakh crores on account of currency in circulation. This is money that never comes back. It only rises year on year. So only in years where balance of payment is around $30-40 billion positive will you break even on liquidity. Now the two are intertwined. So this year was a liquidity deficit year. Therefore, RBI had to step up OMOs, and the phenomenon of crowding out has been addressed. Next year, suppose the start point on core liquidity is zero, and if the dollar actually depreciates and balance of payment is positive for us, the RBI's role will be lesser and the bond market at some juncture will likely experience crowding out. India's domestic capacity to absorb its supply of bonds is just not there. Unless a third balance sheet steps in, we always have a problem.
Are you hinting that the policy answer to this is more FII money, increasing the limit or something?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Or, you know, we at some juncture, so it could be inward FPI money, or at some juncture we go and place bonds outside.
Okay.
I mean, if you just were to take a logical view of this, you have to bridge the difference between your,
I just wanted to know what you were hinting at. I don't think the current RBI consensus has allowed that 5 or 6% of outstanding loans to FPIs or FIIs is about the maximum, is the Reserve Bank's tolerance limit. Let's see if that consensus changes. As Hasib says, we are in an era of consensus being challenged. Let's see if that one gets challenged in 2019. Gentlemen, I have to take a break. But I'm coming back, but lots more questions for all of you, both on fiscal deficit, current account deficit, inflation and growth. The undercurrents of consensus and contradictions, confrontations that the political economy will face in 2019. We have been speaking with Hasib Drabu, economist, former banker and former finance minister of Jammu and Kashmir. We've been speaking with Tarun Ramadurai, professor of financial economics, the Imperial College London, and Suresh Chaudhary, fixed income fund manager from IDFC Mutual Fund. Hasib, you know, the other big consensus that appeared to have broken is giving a direction to the central bank. At the heart of the controversy over the last one quarter has been raiding the Reserve Bank's coffers, its capital. Do you think that that could be an important issue no matter which government comes? Even the Congress former finance minister Chidambaram did not quite attack the use of RBI reserves. Do you think that would play a central role in the emerging politics after the elections?
All right. No, first, coming from you, I mean, particularly to use the word raiding the Reserve Bank.
Okay.
I think it's a bit harsh.
Okay.
We have forgotten the kind of times from 50. Yeah, now it's, okay. You know, because the media now builds it up and, you know, raiding the RBI, and that's how it becomes a controversy. I think the larger point is that what is the relationship going to be after the kind of stuff that we have gone through? It's not that Reserve Bank and Government of India have had a great relationship all these years. Mm. It is a relationship that's built, it is built in stress into it, because one is a lender, one is a borrower. Mm. You know, and the whole question of autonomy we have seen from so many years. I think it's a larger issue, not just about Reserve Bank of India. Mm. It's how the union government, the central government, is looking at institutions. I think that's a key question that will emerge.
Yes.
More specifically on Reserve Bank of India. Yes, I think it is going to go through a phase. I think there are some pluses, some minuses.
No.
The pluses so far, I mean, I've also kind of looked at it. Mm. Yeah.
If I may interrupt, you know, the tradition of not giving a direction to the Reserve Bank has been broken. Now it is much easier for a subsequent government to give such a direction. I will come to Suyash on how the markets will react if, you know, the RBI is directed to do something. But you tell me.
Directions have been given. No, directions have been given earlier as well. It's not that. But I think the way in which it was conveyed was wrong.
Okay.
But as I was coming to it, there, I think there are pluses and minuses in this whole relationship now that have emerged. One, I think it's a good thing to have a board that is actually a board. I've also kind of been tracking the Reserve Bank of India. I didn't even know who the board members have been. There was far too much of, lack of that governance within Reserve Bank of India, even as it was forcing banks for governance. The fact that over the years we have moved into an institutionalized setup of an MPC and all that has helped. I think it's come at a wrong time what has happened. But there is need for a board that is an enlightened board, if not an aggressive board, but a board that understands and has a view. Mm. That is required. Different points of view, different stakeholders have different needs at different times, and they need to be all put on the table before a final view can be taken by the governor. I am still very much in favor of a governor plus his team-led kind of decision-making in RBI. Central government should exercise respect and restraint in dealing with the Reserve Bank of India. On this specific issue, I don't honestly see it in that light, because the Marigam Committee report had submitted. Now the Jalan Committee will give us a recommendation. And I would imagine that the central government, whichever it is, is enlightened enough to look at it from that perspective.
Very quickly, do you think at least this rising tax to GDP ratio that we expected from GST will materialize this year, 2019?
I am a big votary of this. I think it will happen. I just hope the technological glitches will kind of subside. If you see, even of today, the compensation account is in a surplus. Barring a few states, most of them have done much, much better. I do expect GST to provide you the kind of resources that are required, which is why I am taking a view that fiscal deficit will not be a problem.
Okay.
As long as we are able to do two things.
Okay.
Are able to do the reverse charge mechanism.
Okay. Okay.
We should be able to rake in the resources that are required.
Okay.
And what is the RCM is second. Is don't just abolish the MRP system and put a clean GST.
Okay.
Don't do an MRP and then a GST.
Okay, okay. Now I only want to talk about trends in 2019. If there is a different coalition in the centre, either the BJP in a minority and leading a cantankerous NDA or a non-BJP coalition, do you think the GST consensus will continue or will something give?
Well, yeah, I just hope that GST Council, which is, I think, India's first genuinely federal body, has a certain DNA now. I just hope it continues. I also have been in the council and I saw that the finance minister of Gujarat and Maharashtra would actually go against what the center wanted many times.
Okay.
Because what they're bothered about is what happens in their state. So far, GST Council has not discussed or behaved, taken decisions on party lines.
Okay.
And I do hope that continued. I also have a sneaking suspicion that will continue because states are bothered by their problems rather than the national party or those problems.
It's just that the GST Council was born at a time when there was a 335 majority for the ruling party and 57% of Indians lived in BJP-ruled states. Will that consensus continue is a worry I have. Tarun, I wanted to ask you about geopolitics. We didn't give any time to it. The policeman is abdicating his role. So, you know, if U.S. moves away from Syria, moves away from Iran and from Afghanistan, do you think geopolitics will be a bigger worry than we have seen in the last two or three years or two or three decades?
So I think there are several factors that are quite worrying in this context. I mean, certainly it is the case that we're seeing a pullback from a lot of these regions. We're seeing that the U.S. has changed its sort of historical position, seemingly so. We've seen a lot of turnover in the United States recently, certainly at the highest levels of government.
Yes.
There's the Mueller investigation. You know, there's a whole number of different aspects that need to be looked at. And this just adds to this general picture of uncertainty. Now, my personal view on this is that when you have macroeconomic uncertainty, one of the things that policymakers can do is to find a quiet back road to navigate while the macroeconomic picture is potentially worrying or deteriorating. Put differently, if you can find efficiency savings and if you can find a way to fix some of the nuts and bolts or tighten up the structures that you already have. So this means if you can shore up institutional capital by making sure that you strengthen the current state of your institutions, slashing regulations that are unnecessary and putting others that are in place, making sure that, for example, we had this Household Finance Committee and trying to change, you know, or implement some of those recommendations so that we can fix, say, insurance markets or financial markets and maybe use technology to improve tax take. You know, things like this. There are more managerial aspects to the way that you manage the economy.
Than ideological.
That would be the way to navigate in an environment in which you have massive geopolitical uncertainty.
Well, there is a lot of machine learning and AI that is getting used. So hopefully, you know, we will get somewhere in terms of more efficient insurance markets and fund markets. Actually, I have a couple of questions for Suyash, but you have to manage it very quickly, Suyash, in a minute. First of all, do you expect rate cuts or will inflation suddenly surprise? I don't know how, but I think we have there is such a consensus on low inflation. I'm just afraid that a contra can happen. And secondly, do you think this wall of money that came on, you know, financialization of Indian savings, will that continue or will that give?
So to the first point, I think the composition of inflation changes. You know, core comes down somewhat and, you know, the primary food, et cetera, starts to go up. The average inflation will also move up over the course of the next year, but that would probably still not, eliminate the hope of rate cuts because you can do with a lower real rate target in a slowing business cycle, and okay. the core assumption here is that globally the business cycle is slowing. So yes, I would account for rate cuts even with slightly higher inflation.
Okay.
The financialization theme one has to see a little more. You know, the biggest indicator would be that the crowding out phenomenon in India needs to abate. Mm. And so long as, you know, we are always falling short of deposits to finance credit, falling short of savings to finance government borrowing, you can't really put too much of hope on, you know, ongoing financialization. I think we need to see more data on that.
Okay. Well, there are plenty of points, challenges and hopes that our panel has put on the table. Growth may not be as good as we expect because of the slowing global environment. We could perhaps still get rate cuts. And there could be a potential war on institutions. How the political consensus handles this is going to define the political economy trends of 2019. Tarun Ramdurai, Haseeb Drabu and Suyash Chaudhary, thank you very much for joining in what's been a very, very interesting conversation.